We're off on another Away Day introduced by Bernard Falk.
Now, to any railway enthusiast, this place is paradise because I'm surrounded by some of the most extraordinary and beautiful examples from the golden age of steam. Look at this, the Mallard, still the world's fastest steam locomotive, achieved 126 miles an hour in 1938 just outside Peterborough. Then there's the Green Arrow, one of the old faithful locomotives of the 1930s that used to do the run across the border between England and Scotland, as did the Duchess of Hamilton, currently undergoing a facelift. But we're going to the border itself, to the Settle Carlisle Line, where we join my colleague Mike Harding for his Away Day.
Exactly what you'd call a railway fanatic. I'm not the sort of bloke who runs along a station platform with a stopwatch and a notebook checking on the time of the 7:35 to Billericay, but I do like trains, and steam trains in particular. And whenever there's a steam special running, you'll find stood somewhere like this, because this line behind me is the Settle Carlisle Line, one of the greatest, if not the greatest, railway lines in the entire world.
It's under threat now because British Rail look as though they're going to close it down in 1989. So what I'd like to do is take you on a trip with me on the Settle Carlisle, but instead of looking at the line itself, which is done over and over again, I want to use it for something else, because ever since railways were first built, they've been a great inspiration to poets, writers, painters, photographers. It's amazing, in fact, what that small boy James Watt did when he watched that kettle lid bubbling in that farmhouse kitchen in Scotland all those years ago, because the power of steam has inspired the whole world of art. What I want to do is look at the works of great artists like Turner, and even the works of humbler photographers like myself. I don't know if you're very good, I might even show you some of my own pictures.
Shots were taken over a period of 4 years along the Settle Carlisle line. This one, however, isn't one of mine. It's by a bloke called Turner. Railways have inspired the writer as well as the painter, and in fact one of the best known of English poems by Edward Thomas is about a railway station called Adlestrop.
Yes, I remember Adlestrop. The name, because one afternoon of heat, the express train drew up there unwontedly. It was late June. The steam hissed. Someone cleared his throat. No one left and no one came on the bare platform. What I saw was Adlestrop. Only the name. And willows. Willow herb. And grass. And meadowsweet. And haycocks dry. No whit less still and lonely fair than the high cloudlets in the sky. And for that minute, a blackbird sang close by, and round him, mistier, farther and farther, all the birds of Oxfordshire and Gloucestershire.
In fact, you're more likely to hear a curlew here than a blackbird, because this isn't Oxfordshire or Gloucestershire, this is Yorkshire. That's Penny Ghent, and this is Settle Station.
Well, The line starts here in Settle and then heads northward across great bogs and moorland and deep chasms in the limestone until it eventually reaches Carlisle, 70 miles away.
What better way of waiting for a train than listening to Jimmy Rogers?
Every time I see that lonesome railroad train, every time I see that lonesome railroad train, it makes me wish I was going home again. The elderly, look at yonder coming, coming down that railroad track. Look at yonder coming, coming down that railroad track. With the black smoke rolling, rolling from that old smokestack.
When you talk about railway poetry, there's always one name that springs most readily to mind, and that is John Betjeman. Betjeman was the epitome of the Edwardian poet in his neat little verses. He somehow, for me, encapsulated the whole sort of spirit of English railways.
Unmitigated England came swinging down the line. That day the February sun did crisp and crystal shine. Dark red at Kirkby Bentinck stood a steeply gabled farm, mid ash trees and a sycamore in charismatic calm. A village street, a manor house, a church, then tally-ho. We pounded through a housing scheme with telemasts a row, where cars of parked executives did regimented wait beside administrative blocks within the factory gate. She waved to us from Hucknall South as we hooted round a bend. From a curtained front room window did the diesel driver's friend. Through cuttings deep to Nottingham, precariously we wound. The swallowing tunnel made the train seem London's underground.
Pulling out of Settle, the train starts to gather speed and work its way up what engineers have always called the long drag, because the poor fireman had to shovel coal on like Billy-O to get him up to A's Gill. It's inspired a lot of songs and all sorts of poems and stories, and it's also inspired the paintings of a guy called David Weston, who's painted it over and over again. It's an amazing part of the route.
Incidentally, the music you're listening to now is by an ex-footplate man from Nottingham called Dave Goulder.
The Settle Carlisle Railway was built into the land, more viaducts and tunnels than the lines upon your hand. She cuts across the Pennines, over water, rock and air, 70 miles of monument to the men who put her there. Well, I'd like to sit a while by the Settle and Carlisle and delve among the memories at evening. Cascades of falling water down the sides of Penny Ghent, and at the foot of Ingleborough, a solitary tent. The polished brass and uniforms of Settle's age of gold, but memories of better times are difficult to hold. But I'd like to sit a while by the Settle and Carlisle and delve among the memories at evening. Well, an engine's on the turntable, you are climbing down. Dreams become reality as they start to turn around. For the men turn into shadows and the cinders into grass, and the engine's still revolving as it fades into the past. But I'd like to sit a while by the Settle and Carlisle and delve among the memories at evening. Thank you.
This is an intercity D's approaching Bleemore, probably one of the best known parts of the whole line. People come from all over the world to take photographs here because of the famous Ribblehead Viaduct. At one time, there were more than 3,000 people here on this moor, working, living and dying. Nobody knows how many actually died. Hundreds are buried out in the peat bogs. But it is known that more than 100 navvies are buried here in unmarked graves in the little churchyard of Chapel Le Dale.
The navvies were a strange breed of wandering men, hard drinkers, hard fighters, hard workers. Some of them didn't even have proper names. They were known as nicknames like Whistling Jack, Mad Tommy, Barrow John. And they came and went like the mist, leaving nothing but the railway behind them. But there was one navvy, an Irishman from Donegal, called Patrick McGill. He was a self-taught writer who wrote probably a classic of working-class literature, Children of the Dead End. And in his books of poetry, McGill celebrated the lives of the navvies. And one of his last poems, quite a mystical poem in its own way, is an envoy to his pick and shovel, in which he says that the navvies' life, like the great railways he built, and like the pick and the shovel, eventually come to nothing but rust and dust.
When the last long shift will be laboured, and the lying time will be burst, and we go, as picks or shovels, navvies or nabobs must, when you go up on the scrap heap and I go down to the dust, will ever a one remember the times our voices rung, when you were limber and lissom and I was lusty and young? Remember the jobs we've laboured, the heartfelt songs we sung? Perhaps some mortal in speaking will give us a kindly thought. There is a muck pile they shifted. Here is a place where they wrought. But maybe our straining and striving and singing will go for naught. When you go up on the scrap heap and I go down to the dust, little children of labour, food for the worms and the rust, when the last long shift will be laboured, and the lying time will be burst.
There's a way in which the railways could be said to have brought about the birth of a whole musical form, because the blues, the railroad blues, were said to have come about because the Negro slaves in America would hear the trains going past at night, and the trains meant to them freedom, and when they heard the train whistle blowing, that lonesome sound of the train whistle, that seemed to them to be the sound of loneliness and the sound of emptiness. The Negro slaves, being poor, had no musical instruments much to speak about, just these sort of German harmonicas that had been brought over very cheaply. So they used to get hold of these and make the blues notes of the train whistle sort of going, and then they would do all the train noises as well.
Oh!
coming to a hill now. Over the top. Dent station is 4 miles from the village of Dent, and when somebody asked them why they'd built the station so far from the village, they said, happen we wanted it near railway. Well, it's not just outsiders who've been inspired by the line. Dent Women's Institute have won prizes all over the country for their choral piece on the Settle Carlisle.
Away off Awayday, I could see smoke rising for its shanty town at Ribble Inn. It's been built by railway workers. They come a while sen, maybe 2 or 3 year back now, and they've come, folks say, to build a railway atween Settle and Carlisle. I can't help but wonder how they get on up there come winter.
Up the long track, up the long track, 22 miles. 22 miles, 22 miles, 22 miles. Settle Carlisle, Settle Carlisle, Settle Carlisle, Settle Carlisle. Salt Lake City, Sebastopol. Battywife Ho, Battywife Ho, Battywife Ho, Battywife Ho. 6,000 men, 6,000 men, 6,000 men, 6,000 men. 400 dead, 400 dead, 400 dead, 400 dead. 6 years of work, £3 million. Settle Carlisle, Settle Carlisle, Settle Carlisle, Settle Carlisle.
Local photographers John and Eliza Forder and painter John Cook have also drawn heavily on the line for their inspiration.
In the year of 69, they plan to run a train from Settle to Carlisle all across the mountain range. They employed 3,000 navvies to build this mighty road, and across the fells through Appleby the old steam engine rolled. And it's up in the morning, lads, and wind, snow, and hail. Hold fast to your hammers, lads, another rail. It's 72 miles from Settle to Carlisle, across the this country boys in the British Isles. They said it would take 4 years, but it took them near 7. And the first 20 miles sent 400 men to heaven. And it's up in the morning, lads, and wind, snow, and hail. Hold fast to your hammers, lads, lay another rail.
That was the late Mike Donald with his song on the Settle Carlisle. This is the Nigel Gresley. It's a great favourite on the line, and here it's on one of its special runs. About the time that the Nigel Gresley was at its height of powers, filmmakers were turning towards a new form, the documentary. One of the greatest of British documentaries is Night Mail, with its equally famous poem by W.H. Auden.
This is the night mail crossing the border, bringing the cheque and the postal order, letters for the rich, letters for the poor, the shop at the corner of the girl next door, pulling up beat, took a steady climb, the gradient's against her, but she's on time. Past cotton grass and moorland boulder, shoveling white steam over her shoulder, snorting noisily as she passes, silent miles of wind-bent grasses, birds turn their heads as she approaches, stare from the bushes at blank-faced coaches, sheepdogs cannot turn her course, they slumber on with paws across, in the farm she passes, no one wakes, but a jug in a bedroom gently shakes. The climb is done.
Down towards Glasgow she descends. Towards the steam tugs, yelping down the glade of cranes. Towards the fields of apparatus, the furnaces, set on the dark plain like gigantic chessmen. All Scotland waits for her. In the dark glens, beside the pale green sea lochs, men long for news.
Letters of thanks, letters from banks, letters of joy from the girl and the boy, receipted bills and invitations to inspect new stock, visit relations and applications for situations and timid lovers, declarations and gossip, gossip from all the nations, new circumstantial news, financial letters with holiday snaps to enlarge in, letters with faces scrawled in the margin, letters from uncles, cousins and aunts, letters to Scotland from the south of France, letters of condolence to Highlands and Lowlands, notes from overseas to Hebrides, written on paper of everything with the pink, the violet, the white and the blue, the chatty, the catty, the boring, adoring, the cold and official. All the hearts are boring, clever, stupid, short and long, the typed and the printed and the spelled all wrong.
The Sir Nigel Gresley's slightly more famous twin, the Mallard, slides gracefully into Gargrave Station. It's still the fastest steam locomotive in the world, holding the record at 126 miles per hour. But what takes place now is a kind of pit stop. Unlike the racing circuit, everything is done at a calm, sedate pace. And the crowd love it. So, after a quick wash and brush up, she's on the move again. Sheer poetry in engineering. If ever there was an A train, this is it. Even those to whom the sounds of the trains themselves are sheer music.
So this is Carlisle Station. It's the end of the line for the Settle Carlisle. And in a way, it may be the end of the line, full stop. Because by springtime next year, if British Rail get the way, the line is going to be killed stone dead. And if that happens, we'll be missing not just 70 miles of steel rail, but something else too. Entire communities are going to be isolated, left without any transport whatsoever, stuck there in the Dales. And as well as that, there'll be no more poetry, no more songs, no more music, no more paintings. And I think if that happens, then the world's going to be a greyer and a much sadder place. Well, it now looks as though the line's going to be saved. Let's hope that it's true.